very much.
Thank you very much. I welcome everyone listening to us this morning. Before I commence, I would like to use this opportunity to greet Biafrans all over the world, friends of Biafra, freedom lovers around the world. Our leader is Mazin Nnamdi Kanu. I salute you. Shabbat Shalom. Good morning from here. I'm speaking from my location. I'm Rabbi Charles. Mazi, when the sister was praying, Sister Rachel, Elohim, you know, at a time, Elohim kind of touched my spirit to look into something. Actually, I planned something else to say, but when I remember, when she was talking, I remembered. I say, yes, indeed, this is actually what the Lord is doing. It is the work of the Lord. She said that they are telling their children from generation to generation about what happened in Egypt. Am I correct, sir?
Yes, sir.
Am I correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That means the story in the Bible is true. It is a national celebration in Israel. Am I correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you're right.
Yes. I am seeking your, our opinion because you are there. So that anyone listening to us from any part of the world, we know that this is not a makeup of Mazin Nnamdi Kanu or the makeup of a made-up story by Mazi Uche Obilo or a made-up story by Rabbi Charles speaking from his location all the time. It is not. This is a true story. The Bible history, Bible historian made us to know that this event indeed happened. It really, really happened. So on this note, I want us to look at the particular place where I'm going to draw the context from. I still title what I'm saying, the God of Wonders. It is a wonderful thing that it's an act of wonder. Yes, let me put it this way. It is an act of wonder that the people that were in slavery for 430 years came out of it. All of a sudden, they came out of it. It took the miracle working hand of God to take Israel out of Egypt. If God never done that, imagine the direction the world will be going at this particular point in time. There will be chaos in Egypt now, because they will fight the Egyptian to the last, and the thing we escalate to other African countries. But people don't know that it is God that avoided that chaos. And guess what God did? He planted them in the midst of their enemies. So anybody that come to tell me that Bible history is not true, I will tell the person, I think you are very, very insane. And anyone that comes to make it to look like a religious thing, I will tell the person you are beside yourself. You are not normal. It is not a religious thing. It is a reality. I hear people saying, take this thing away from the struggle. And I ask the person, the leader of this movement, who called him? Is it a president of one country that called him and sent him to go and deliver the people of Biafra? Who called him? Who sent him? So why all of a sudden, because you are involved, you said, let us not talk about God in this. You have a problem with God. Let us remove him from this struggle. Let us make it secular. Elohim sent him. Nobody sent him. When we were sleeping, when we were in our state of reprobacy, Elohim sent him to warn the whole of Africa, to warn Biafra first, and to warn Africa about the pending danger coming to Africa. Before I continue, let me just reference Elohim and invite him once again in this place where I'm speaking from to give me understanding and in-depth knowledge of what I'm about to say. Eternal Rock of Ages, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient God, the great I am that I am, the one who said that his name is Jehovah. I call upon your name this morning. I ask you to do that which no man can do. Give us understanding. Give us receptive heart to receive your word. Give us clear vision on what you're about to say. All this I ask in the name of your only son, Yeshua HaMashiach. I pray. Mazi, Obilo, I want to, I had planned to go to a certain place in the scripture, but I am not going to go there because of the development, because of the impact. But I want to look into a certain place in the Holy Book. I think I'm gonna take this thing in a, you know, because if I go to read all these things, there will be time will go against us. But we all know the scriptures most of the time, and I believe that God will do the rest as I go into the scripture right now. You know, in the book of Exodus, we are dealing with something that is beyond human being. How God came strong and delivered Israel out of Egypt. It is something that man cannot be able to think of. And God said in his word, he said through terror, God delivered Israel out of Egypt. I repeat again, through terror, God delivered Israel out of Egypt. So what am I saying? God terrorized Egypt. God did not terrorize Egypt because he hated Africa. No. For those who we misinterpret this, he did not terrorize Egypt because he hated black race. It's not at all. It's not exactly what God did. Pharaoh, he was specifically dealing with Pharaoh. The man that held them down. All of a sudden, he changed the narrative. Remember, when Joseph interpreted the dream to the other Pharaoh that later died, that Pharaoh took out his ring, and placed it in Joseph's finger. And that ring matched. The ring was not oversized. And it wasn't smaller, but it fitted into the finger of Joseph. He took golden necklace and decorated him and made him ride on horse, on chariots, and told people that this is the second in command in Egypt. He said, for the fact that you know, Pharaoh tested Joseph to know his state of mind. He said, what can I do now? And Joseph told Pharaoh, he said, select a wise man. Select somebody who is wise, who can be able to run this thing that I reveal to you with place. Let him build storehouses, storerooms like barns of food, and let him store food for the period of 7 years in abundance. Because the level of famine that we hit, we consume those years in abundance. People will never believe that there was a time there was abundance in Egypt. And Pharaoh said, who else will I send that will understand this vision if not you that interpreted it? You see how God does his selection. Biafra is coming. And our leader was saying, if Biafra comes, I will just leave and go and start doing something else. And the Biafrans are saying, whom are you going to hand us over to? Whom are you going to hand us over to? I know it's going to be political election and this and that, but if you are not involved, we may not trust the person that will be coming. I am seeing Biafra already. So are you not going to come and do this thing? Let's test you for another five. I don't know how it's going to work, whether are we going to be using 4 years or 5 years per term or 10 years per term. I don't know about that. Because I remember one man of God in Africa who was suggesting to the country where he originated from that we shouldn't do it like the way all the world is doing their politics, to stop this man inhumanity to man. That once the winning party takes over power, they will start oppressing the one that opposed them. He brought out, mapped out contingent plan. If you haven't read it, go and contact Archbishop Nicholas Duncan Williams of Ghana. He brought out this strategy, how Africa should run their state of government, different from what other Europeans or the rest of the world are doing. I read it and it made sense to me. So I don't know how long we're going to do it, how we're going to plan it and make it look different from what these people are doing. That looks like a joke. Like once you get into power, you begin to brutalize anyone that opposed you. You begin to kill those of opposition to secure you to secure your another 4 years term. If you can't kill them with this hunger, you kill them with terrorism. If you can't succeed with terrorism, you bring vaccination and kill them with anything you can think of. But I was sleeping, lying down last night. At the middle of the night, a call came to my phone. And that is where I was about to hit. But when I realized what is going on in the nation of Israel, Elohim said, go back again and speak about this just now. You know, the person told me, he said, do you realize that French government now send their vessel to secure the land of the territory of Bakassi. They sent a vessel there to secure that place, that is their territory. That, what are we going to do now? I told him to go and open the book of 2 Kings chapter 6 and read it. That is where the answer lies. The guy said, it's like you are waiting for me to ask you this question. He called me from a foreign country. He said, what are we going to do now? I said, go and look at the book of 2 Kings chapter 6 verse 17. To be precise. When the servant of the prophet went to the prophet and said, we are surrounded by the enemies. We are surrounded. We're not going to come out of this alive. And the prophet looked at him and said, he said, Lord, please, I am not worried about the enemy surrounding us right now. I'm worried about this person that is a member of this movement that is very worried. Now he began to pray a prayer for God to open the servant's eyes to see those that are with them. He did not worry about the enemy surrounding them. That for him, for the prophet, that it was, those enemies are done deal. But he was worried about a comrade who is now worried, panicking. He said, oh Lord, open his eyes to see. Because he didn't see, he fails to see. That is why he's disturbing me with all this news, that I am now surrounded. Who are they that they will surround me? Who gave them the power to surround me and to kill me? Where is this my God that I've been calling upon? And Elohim opened the servant's eyes. I suspect the name of the servant to be Gehazi, who later died through disobedience when he was disobeying the order of the prophet and went and took gifts from Naaman, who came for healing. I suspect it was Gehazi. So he prayed. He said, let God open the eyes of Gehazi to see. And when the eyes were open, he saw battalions of soldiers surrounding the city. And the enemies looked like ants before them. And he came back, he said, oh my God, I can see now. He said, now, stop being worried about all these things. Let French government send military ship to Bakassi. I don't know where they got the power to claim Africa, that Africa belongs to them. What will happen to European nations, European nations, plural, that are involved in the killing and the destruction of the children of Chukwu Okike Abiyama, the Biafrans. Europeans will never recover from it for 100 good years. Mark what I'm telling anyone listening to me today. Mark my word. They will never recover from the destruction. Sudden destruction will hit them. They won't know where that thing is coming from. But they will feel the pain of Elohim, says the Most High God, Chukwu Okike Abiyama. They will feel the pain. The time they did it, 1967 to 70, and they combined forces. They came, they saw, and they believed they conquered. And they were celebrating. Oil and gas began to flow to their directions. And they began to use the proceeds, the resources from Africa to build their continent, European continent, and made Africans to begin to run to Europe for shelter, for better life, as they say. And the Africans, some of them perished in the sea. Some of them got drowned somewhere along Libya. Some died in the desert in attempt to cross over. Some couldn't make it. All in the quest to get better life and liberation. But Elohim said, you are making mistake. You don't have to run away from them. You got to go and contend with them. And I will give you the enabling power to destroy them and to defeat them. I know the people bringing them to Nigeria, this contraption called Nigeria, the people that brought them, the minority brought them, that is the Fulanese. The Fulanese are not Nigerians. So to say, they are not from that geographical location, because there is nothing like a place called Nigeria. Nigeria was created in 1960 by ordinary people who doesn't know about the makeup of those regions. They came there and gave them name, said their name should be called or must be called Nigeria, and they removed the old map and put up a new map. That map gives them the ability, the enablement to be stealing, to be looting. If they don't take the oil, the proceeds they sold and brought the money, they will induce some governors of the Fulanese. They will now bring that money back to Europe and put it in their banks. And the people of that regions will be dying of hunger. And the Europeans will come and make video and photograph and saying, let's help Africa because Africa is dying of poverty and hunger. This is the greatest deception of the century. That's what they're doing. Are we surprised about the death of the president of Tanzania who killed that man? Are we surprised? If you speak, they believe that the moment they kill somebody, they have gotten victory. Who told them that? Who told them? Did Yeshua feel God frightened of death? Moses knew what he was undertaking before he took the journey. Even the prophets of old, Elijah was hunted. Elijah was hunted by the authority. Yeshua HaMashiach was hunted even when he was a baby. They hunted him. He had to run to Egypt. God gave the wise men that came, money to take that money and hand it over to Joseph, the caretaker, so that he will have what it takes to go to Egypt. He will pay for his transport, pay for accommodation, pay for security, and pay for their feeding. He did that. That was the reason wise men came and gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. That was just for them to sell it and get the money and now undertake the journey. He said, stay there until I bring you word, because I'm going to kill those ones that are looking for his life. I'll kill them. And Joseph didn't know the gravity of the assignment Elohim gave him. But I want to go back to the scripture quickly. You know, the final blow that happened to Egypt is the 10th plague. The 10th plague. The death of the firstborn. That is what the children of Israel are celebrating today in the state of Israel. The Passover. Passover means, God said, I will pass over the land of Egypt. He said, I will read from Exodus chapter 11. And the Lord said to Moses, from verse 1, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. Afterward, he will let you go from here. One more plague, only one more plague. That is wonder God was talking about. I have given you 9 plagues. But I have another one that is remaining. That one, Pharaoh cannot handle it. After that, he will tell you to leave. And if you go and read that Exodus chapter 11 down completely, you will see it written there. Time will fail me, but I will just paraphrase on it. See, I will read verse 4. No, I will start from verse 2. They speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor, and every woman from her neighbor, articles of silver, articles of gold. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Moreover, the man Moses was very great in the land of Egypt. He was regarded as a great man, as what our leader is doing. In the sight of Pharaoh's servants and in the sight of the people, even the zoo soldiers regard Mazinandekano as a great man. Some of the politicians regards our leader as a great man. Even those in the Hausa tribe, they regard him as a great man. They wish to have somebody like him. Somebody that never compromised. Somebody who doesn't want to think about the sweetness of money. I know that some people have some resentment, some feeling. Oh, the way he speaks. Don't forget about the way he speaks. Listen to the content of the message. A messenger sometimes gets frustrated because people that he came to speak to are not listening, are not paying attention. So in order to get your attention, he can say, you are very foolish for not understanding me. And you say, are you insulting me? He's not insulting anybody. He's just telling you how frustrated he could be. He is, because you don't understand what you should have understood. So he gets a bit, upset with the situation. Some people have different ways of communication. If they communicate and you fail to understand it, you will say, come closer. Let me tell you something. When you come closer, he will knock your head. Say, you should know what I'm telling you. He will give you pain. So that pain will make you to think. Now verse 4 said, then Moses said, thus says the Lord, about midnight, I will go out into the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die. I didn't say that, oh. Mazobila, I hope I'm coming out clear. I didn't say that.
Mazi, you're coming out wonderfully well. Please go ahead.
I didn't say that I will kill the zoo. Elohim said to Egypt, to Pharaoh, all the firstborn. He said, why should I kill the... People will ask, why should I kill the firstborn? He said, Israel is my son and my firstborn. I made covenant with Israel. So if you kill my firstborn, I will kill your son, your firstborn also. I will kill them. Anything that opened the womb, in fact, he went further to say, anything that opened the womb, even the animals, the firstborn of animals, even the firstborn of birds, Tolo Tolo, I will kill the firstborn of Tolo Tolo. He's serious. And he came back and told the children of Israel, his people. How did he know them? He know them by their blood lineage. God looks into blood. The word of God said, your life is in your blood. No, but I can't do, if you have any sickness here, what the expert, medical expert will do is to take your blood and synthesize it. The moment they drop it into that machine, the machine will tell them the nature of sickness or disease that individual is having. That is how they do it here. There is no long story or bend down, stand up, turn around, do this. No. They will just say, just go and give your blood. They will take the person's blood and go to their lab and see this, and they will synthesize it. They have, if they drop the blood, on that machine, in few hours, the machine will be talking. The machine will tell you how far. Even in your vehicle that you drive now, they don't even go and start pulling the back axle, lifting it up, open bonnet, let start it, let me hear. No. If you carry your vehicle to garage, they will plug computer right in your vehicle. Once they plug that computer, they will now tell the computer, tell us, ask this vehicle to tell us what is wrong with it. And the computer will be analyzed and said, the top cylinder gasket is not working. Brake pad is finished. Clutch plate is gone. It's the computer telling everything. The man, the owner of the technician will be standing by. That computer, little thing, will be communicating to your vehicle, asking your vehicle questions. He said, the steering rack is not in order. So the oil, the hydraulic fluid is almost finished. Top it up. And finally, we say, your radiator is leaking partially. Change it. the technicians will be writing, even not writing, print. He will print every transcript, all the results, he will print it out. Say, these are the things that is wrong with your vehicle. Go and buy all those stuff. If you can't buy it, you consider scrapping this vehicle and buy a new one. That is how it is being done here. They don't pull anything. Even if you go to MOT, the same. They will plug the system, the machine, your vehicle will be talking to the computer, telling the computer what is wrong with it. So Elohim went through the blood and searched out the children of Israel in Egypt. He knows them. He was looking at their blood lineage, their blood makeup, and said, these are the children of Israel. Even if they are half caste, he will pick them up, say, these are my children, the children of Israel that are scattered all over the world as a result of anger. They disobeyed me, I scattered them, now I am gathering them. He didn't say, I am calling them or picking them. He said, gathering. Gathering is different from picking. Gathering is to search and put them together and bring them back to their promised land. That is what Elohim is doing. And this is exactly how he located us. And the confusion is, why are we not light skin and curly hair and long hair and all those stuff? It is the geographical location where Elohim planted us that made us to be like this. And made us to sound different from the ones in the Middle East. But we are the children of Israel. We have the link. By their fruits you shall know them. By their invention, inventive behavior, innovative mindset, building mindset. The people that build that contraption are Biafrans. And some of them are very hell-bent to, what you call it, to Nigeria because of what they have, their investment. So they know that they are being oppressed. They know that they have been marginalized, and they are marginalizing them. They are seeing the killings, but they cannot talk because of their investment, because of their money. Look at the pastors in that contraption. They cannot talk because of their congregation, because they threaten them. If you speak against this regime, we will send simultaneous bombings in your congregation. And once we do that, nobody will come there anymore. They threaten them. And to the news media, mainstream medias, they told them, if you ever report what is happening, we will bomb your studios. We will destroy everything that you have labored for. We will take them out, and you will know that we mean business. So are you going to shut up or do what we tell you, or you want to talk? They say, no, please, I don't want to talk. Let me keep quiet. That's what they're doing. So a lot of people are screaming, oh, can't you see it? BBC. And BBC is there plenty or painting a different scenario. And they are using who? Igbo-speaking people that they are paying fast salaries.
that if they go to any other secular job seeking for employment, they won't get them that kind of payment. So they are using them. And these idiots will look at if the situation and be writing something else, saying something else, because they are paid not to say the truth. So that is exactly what they did before. We read the history, we saw that they used not only food blockade, media blockade as well. And the gentleman told me, look at what France just did. They came to Bakassi with ship or war vessel. They want to protect the place because of what might happen. I said to them, French will perish there. Are you scared of them? Are you scared of French government? They will not be able to contain the problem that will come to them because of Biafra. They will never be able to contain that problem. They can't do it. Not anymore. So leave it and see how they would drown. They will get drowned in that location where they are. The people will rise up and they have no choice than to flee. They will run. I want to read this particular place. Then I conclude what I'm saying, what I'm about to say now. God told them that at midnight, a certain angel will walk in the city of Egypt, and every male child will die. He said, mark your doorpost and your lintel with blood. He said, I will read verse 6. Then there shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as was not like it before, nor shall be like it again. But against none of the children of Israel shall a dog move his tongue. Nothing will happen there. Nothing will happen. Nothing will happen in Goshen. I will protect Goshen. But in other areas, I will strike them. You see, it's verse 8 said, and all this your servants shall come down to me and bow down to me, saying, get out, and all the people who follow you. After that, I will go out. Then he went out from Pharaoh in great anger. Moses left Pharaoh. You see, Moses had anger in him too. As they are accusing our leader of being angry or having anger in him, Moses was frustrated with what Pharaoh was doing. Remember, there are 10 plagues. He's at the number 10, the 10th one. Not 11, not 12, but number 10. And interestingly, the administrative office of British that framed up that contraption, their administrative office address is number 10. Is it coincidence? when you mention number 10 Downing Street, everybody knows what you're talking about. It's number 10. And the 10th plague will happen, and they will let Biafra go.
You see,
God is not a man that you should lie, neither the son of man that you should repent. If he said it, he will do it. If he declare it, he will bring it to pass. It is not my job to think, how will he do it? I will not think about it. How is he going to carry this thing out? He's going to do it. All we need to do is to stand strong and stand in faith, believing that Elohim will do it. He will do it. The French government can come with all their bulldozing powers and the nuclear military capability. They did it in the past, and the prophet was not even moved. It was the servant that was even panicking. He left what he could have been doing. He started praying to God to open the eyes of his servant before he make mistake. And Elohim opened the eyes of the servant, and the servant screamed and said, my Lord and my God, do we have all this as sinner? He said, yes. The rest is history. If you read it, you will see what happened there. Everything is documented. If the children of Israel as today are celebrating Passover, and some certain foods in the contraption called Nigeria saying, what is this religion all about? This is not, it's not a, it's a new Christianity. I'm not attacking any religion. I believe. Elohim made it clear. He said, I give you 10 commandments. It's not 10 suggestions. I give you 10 commandments. It's a commandment. It's not suggestions. So if you think I am suggesting to you, you are making a mistake. If you go contrary to the commandment, I'll kill you straight away. If you go contrary, if you go against this 10 commandment, you are going against your life. You will perish right there. It's a commandment. It's not a suggestion. It's not 10 contribution. It's not 10 compelling. It's a 10 commandment. A command goes out from authority. The only person that can issue command is someone in authority. Elohim is in authority. He created heaven, the heaven and earth. He created the state of Israel. He created Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Israel. He created them. He said, Israel is my son and my firstborn. If you kill them, I will kill you. In extension, Biafra is the son of Eri and Arodi. As Zhu keeps killing them, he said, I will destroy Nigeria, says Elohim. I will kill that name, Nigeria. Nigeria will never be in any map of the nations. Nigeria will be removed from the nations in United Nations. In this United Nations we are looking at. I didn't see the Nigerian map anymore there. It will happen. There might be a change, but I did not see that map again. I know how long it took the nations of United Nations to accept the nation of Israel among the nations in United Nations. It didn't happen when they became an independent nation. When they fought Six-Day War, they were not there. They came. How they are coming to us? They said we can't let them be a nation. And God said it even in His word. The evil ones conspired. They said we cannot let them be a nation. We will go against them. We will stop them. Are they not doing it today? Aren't we seeing scripture being fulfilled? Remember the former president of Iran, Mr. Ahmadinejad, who looked at Israel and said that Israel is a one bomb nation. That the only thing they can do is to enrich uranium. And when they enrich uranium to a certain centrifuge, they will unleash it, guide it. They are working on it. And it has taken so many lives. They are scientists. They are dying. They don't know what is killing them. Unknown gunmen, I can say, was busy terminating them. Because if they allow them to get to that level, get that nuclear capability, they will send guided missiles to Abi. And the rest will be history. And Elohim is looking at them saying, you think I'm not seeing what you are doing? I'm looking at you. Go and hide it. Seven-story building underground. I am there already. When you are digging that seven-story building, I was there already. I know the format that you are using. I know you are scientists. I know the people helping you from countries. I know them. I have their names. And I will take them out. Just like those ones holding Biafra down. They will go and recycle with some certain people within IPOB, and all of a sudden, they start speaking with a different voice and tongue. And remember, the worst part of it, these guys were with IPOB, and they were given fantastic position. All of them were given fantastic positions, and they were being celebrated. And a little voice who saw what they were doing, saw what they were doing in the secret, came out and was screaming. And some group of people came on air saying, let us stone Rabbi. All the mad. All the wakoko, bakagi isi. Keko si fuya. They never believed. Aren't you seeing those idiots insulting our leader openly now? what I see in what I see in the dark, if they put every light, you may not see it. And those ones are now, the BBC is granting interview to them, and they believe that they will come and undo what our leader is doing. I have said it before I joined the struggle. No matter what, I will never be upset with any. Nobody is above mistake. Moses even made mistake. Anything that our leader does or said, I will be upset with him. Never, never, never. I can get, you know, like first shock, but I will not. I have reasons. Any day you meet me on one-on-one, I will tell you reasons why you shouldn't be upset. And when, let's focus on Biafra first. Let's look at the people killing us. Let us look at the people destroying our lives, saying that they can never live to see us becoming a nation. That is the greatest challenge, and Elohim wants to do it desperately. He needs men to do it. So if you hate me for what I'm saying, that is your business. It is your business. You can hate me to any level you want to hate me, but I'm telling everyone of us the truth. I'm telling us the truth. Because these people are not going to, you know, relent. If a strong hand didn't contend against them, they will never stop. It's never, I have never read in the history where Fulani, after conquering people, he said, well, we are tired of this conquering thing we are doing. Now we can let you go. We don't want to be conquering you anymore. We don't want you to be slaves. If that is the case, they would have done it to the Yorubas in Kwara State. They're still there today. They would have done it to the Hausas. Hausas are feeling it. They are speaking out. Hausas are very, most of them are very honest people. They are speaking out. The Middle Belt, the Benue State, they are killing them today. Have you seen them relenting, saying, we want to stop? What aren't they planning to assassinate the governor of Benue State, Samuel Otto, Governor Samuel Otto? They're planning to assassinate him. How many times haven't they mapped out plan how to assassinate most of the IPOB principal officers? Don't we know about that? Don't we know? I even stumbled into something that was published. Don't entertain any interview from any news media, because if you're a member of IPOB, if you do that, you are doing it at your own detriment. It was written and signed by head of DOS, Chike Dozim. He signed, I read it. So you can see that these people don't mean, they don't joke. They mean business. They are not joking. So the children of Israel, we are in Egypt, and Elohim told them to mark the lintel, the doorpost and the lintel, that the killer will not look at the faces. The only thing that killer will see and pass over your house is just the blood on the doorpost and the lintels. If the killer sees it, that killers will go. The angel of death was released, and they pass over Egypt. And they know through blood makeup. How did Elohim know that this person is the firstborn? Most people read it, they will think, oh yeah, there is miracle there. He could be able to trace the person that opens the womb. He knows. So when Elohim said, your hair are numbered, it's different from the hairs of your head are counted. He didn't only count it, he numbered it. He numbered the hairs of your head. He knows number 17. He knows number 10. He knows your street. He knows your street address. He knows the governmental office. He knows number 10 Downing Street. He knows them. He knows the parliament, EU parliament. He knows them. He knows the ICC's office. He knows them. Elohim knows. He knows the station office in New York. He knows them. He said, I will show you signs, I will show you wonders. After this thing, this one, Pharaoh can't handle it. You know what? He said, before then, go and ask them to give you gold. I once told our people, I said, we cannot leave the contraption empty-handed. I go to give me my scriptures. I no give me in the spirit. Oh, but I'm not going to see about a weapon. Consult or rabbi na direct. I will tell you what to do. They will look at you. They will look at you and look down on you. Say, who are you? Ijego. Am I written? Everything to do where we go. And when things that you don't know. And Elohim said, you won't go empty-handed unless you signed it. You chose it. Say, you know what? Give me Biafra, I am going empty-handed. As for me, I am not going empty-handed. Agagemaga Baraka, Ga Biafra Baraka. That is where we are right now. On this note, I am concluding that if you stand strong, stand firm, you will see the miracle, the wonder-working power of God. And those of us who did contact our brother, Pastor Jack, I thank you. Those who gave him support, I thank you. Those who will still give him support, I thank you. But I have something for you. If you give Pastor Jack anything, give me a call. I will tell you what to do. Agwara m unu si na ihe osuji ka anunu bu obere obohuri si nani. Anunu bere opuru oto, manu osu bere obohuri si nani. And also adi enwe blood hemorrhage on his brain because he's wired to be in that position. Iye mazi nani kanu jika most of these noisemakers, all these noisemakers, wona Elohim nyeri esan, nyeri a mandate. I'm a gum afugomo already. I'm a mihen jasya no naso siibo keta. Afugomi already the mandate. Iya guariya me. Oma onye senderia no ya koji ukuku itua. Oboro na madu senderia. Wanne agama abunu no madu senderia. Onye poria okua ya biya meha abo Elohim. Omeregini o ekui piria through us. And other ones that we join in the near future to do this thing, to bring this thing to conclusion. As for Nigeria, Nigeria will be destroyed completely. Those that are propelling Nigeria, all of them will go. If they don't get destroyed there, they will run off and go to exile, and they will never come back. I never read in the history where Idi Amin came back from Saudi Arabia. Idi Amin died and was buried in Saudi. So many of them, Mobutu Sese Seko, ran off and never came back to Cote d'Ivoire, to DRC, Zaire, former Zaire. He never came back. He never came back. He left and died there. So they won't come back. They will run. When the people stand up, they will run. So don't get this thing mixed up, saying this is about Onyendu and all this. Propaganda lies that are dishing out online. Onyibe talking. They never got paid. But one of them told me how much they were paying Onyibe. Onyibe is denying that he never got money. That nobody supported him. Nobody knows where he lives. Nobody knows how he's coming out preaching in the morning and in the evening. Onyibe forgot that many of us called him and said, how are you faring yourself? He lied to us. I contacted somebody, one of them who followed them into this. That person told me, who told you that Onyibe doesn't get paid? He gets paid. This is what he normally gets. And anytime you see him screaming, blah, 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 you know that his money has arrived. He had received a lot. So a freedom fighter who gets moved by a lot is not a freedom fighter. He's In football in those days in Lagos, they call them anywhere belly face. He's not a tactical footballer. Anywhere his stomach is facing, that is where he's going to shoot the ball into. He doesn't know how to dribble and navigate his way out of that position. If it's facing corner kick, he will shoot it there. Over the bar, boom, he will shoot it. Throwing, he will shoot it there. Because why? His stomach is facing there. Okay. Those who are compelled to do freedom fighting because of their stomach needs. You see them, when the thing is not coming, they will change position and start insulting that man. Onyara, you are nobody. You are insulting Biafra. If you insult Biafra, I will keep on insulting you. you guys are sick. Mazi Obilo, on this note, I pray that Elohim, they said a word is enough for a wise. Yes. I pray that Elohim will bless this word and activate this word in the minds of people. And everything that I declared concerning Biafra will come to pass. Biafra will come. Nigeria will be known. All Nigerian handlers, evil men and women who are killing people, who are destroying lives and properties, who are wired to hate people just because they are blessed people, all of them will be destroyed. One by one, they will perish. And those nations that are assisting them, helping them, equipping them militarily, those nations will be visited. Sudden destruction will hit them. Plague will hit them. Terrorism will hit them heavily. And they will feel it. Because if they feel it, they will know that the Most High God is interested in the affairs of Biafra. They will know. I am declaring it. So when it happens, they will know that a prophet came on earth and said this thing, that it will happen to them. They will see plague upon plague. You know, natural disaster upon natural disaster. Terrorism, man-made terrorism. And it will hunt them down until they give up. On this note, I'll sign off from here. Thank you very much. Shalom.